So I'm joined here for the vote by Colin Matthews. Well, we were saying what to describe yourself as, an entrepreneur, a kind of a promoter in a way, like on a grand scale.
Yes, I think so, yes. Yeah. Yes. Over 50 years, I seem to remember. I seemed to have frightened myself the other week when I thought, when did I start? 1969, and here we are.
Yes.
I'm still doing it.
And it's been an illustrious career. You've contributed a lot to the city, and that's what we're going to be exploring today. So maybe explain, a bit about what you do first and the kind of what your career's been.
I started off in Brighton in 69, working at the art college. It was an art college then.
Yeah.
And I found myself DJing in what we call the Friday nightclub, which was a sweaty little pit that some people seem to remember. And from there it grew, and I started doing soul music, and then I promoted soul bands, Chaka Khan, as we just mentioned earlier. It grew from there. We were doing bands every week, We ended up doing Nina Simone. We do reggae. We were doing Gregory Isaacs, Dennis Brown, Toots and the Maytals, and then... And we were running clubs on the seafront as well, soul clubs. And then in the early 80s, I started a new romantic club called Savannah, which I still think people still remember. That went well. I started working on festivals. I was always been part of the festival that turned into the Fringe when it became independent. Then I also promoted animation festivals, puppetry festivals in the 90s up into the 2000s. I then got more involved in a local festival, which I'm involved in now in Hurstbury Point, 2-week festival every year. I ended up chairing Zap Productions. That is different to Zap Art. Zap Productions was the arm that produced the big outdoor stuff that people would have seen in Preston Park and a lot of French companies coming to the seafront and doing stuff. I'm just thinking what else I was chairing. I seem to get confused. I chair a group that puts arts into hospitals at Royal Sussex County. Yeah. And a part of the new build that's going on is integrated art that goes into there, like roof gardens and photography into patients' waiting rooms and that, to make the whole place look much more inviting to visitors and staff and that. So that's
a big career, really. So what going back from the beginning, what kind of got you involved in kind of promoting music? And where's that spark come from? Because obviously Brighton's got some very, a lot of bands and a lot of creativity happens in Brighton, and you seem to have used that
A very good one. I was talking to someone the other day, and I was talking back even further back than 1969. I can remember being the age of 13 or 14, and I was in the local drama group, but on the committee.
Yeah.
Or I was at the local youth club, but I was the treasurer. And it seemed to me, and this person said, it seems to me you had a calling that you wanted to be into this sort of thing. It's never been work, though I did get paid for it, which is really nice. But it was just bringing communities together, really. And the greatest satisfaction is having a germ of an idea and seeing it come fruition, where you see 2,000 people enjoying themselves, That's what drives me.
Yes. Yeah, yeah. What was Brighton like then in the kind of the late 60s? What made it? It was obviously a different place to what it is now. So what was it like then? And what made you kind of establish those acts? And maybe we can focus on a few of those acts, like Chaka Khan being one of them, for example.
Yeah, I think it was a period of the 60s was a period of that newfound freedom, I think, of youngsters and what have you. I don't know if I can say it, but so when the contraception came in and
lots of new laws
came out and people were, and it was that sort of, not quite free love, but you get that feeling. And Brighton has always been a very sort of like, it's a folly, it's a place to enjoy yourself and always very liberal and that. And I always found audiences is very receptive to new things and that, especially during the Fringe, willing to try stuff. And that's where I started out. And as you mentioned there, Chaka Khan, Rufus and Chaka Khan was the first band I did in sort of mid 70s at the what was then the Corn Exchange, you know.
So were they formed in, was it formed in Brighton then? Chaka Khan, was she?
No. She's American and she was touring. I used to work with some music people in London, and we used to book bands as they were coming up. Yeah. We would do new bands like up and coming bands like Culture Club or UB40 or comedians like Lenny Henry or, you know, so it was very early days for them in their careers as well. You know,
yeah. So you've met all of these, you know, all of those people?
Most of the time,
Any stories to tell on that? I mean, what are UB40 like? Because I know they're still going.
I didn't know them so well, but a story I do tell is we promoted Nina Simone and twice at the Dome, and the second time the tickets weren't selling so fast. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, the phone rang at my house, and my wife picked up the phone, and Nina Simone said, "It's Nina Simone here. I need to talk to Colin Matthews." And my wife said, "I'm sorry, you can't. He's asleep." Put the phone down. So you never come. But then she came and did the concert, and she was quite. She was like a 55-year-old schoolgirl, I wouldn't say cantankerous, but she could get riled. And she sang the whole concert out of key, you know, sort of thing, you know. Yeah. So it's experiences like that. Or I can remember doing Jules Holland and having a rider which says, "Hey, we've got six first class. Why are there six first class stamps on the rider?" And he said to me, "Just to make sure you read it."
You know? that's very good. That's quite clever, actually.
So, yes, it's all these things. And we did. We did De La Soul at the Brighton Centre. We did quite big stuff, you know.
Yes. Yeah. And I know my colleague Bill Smith knows you very well.
So we promoted together in early years when what is now Jubilee Street was a car park. Sort of disused, it was just a demolished building site, really. Yeah. And we used to put very crude marquees up there for Brighton Fringe and do acts there. So we go.
What's it like promoting a big band? Do you worry about, because obviously some people can be a bit diva-ish, should we put it that way? So, I mean, do you ever worry about that? And how much of the time does it, I mean, what are some of the crazy diva-ish demands you've had? Because people are always interested in that, aren't they? If you have somebody, you know, like, you know, only Blue Smarties or something, it's what one
blue
of the bands
are. I suppose if you don't mind me talking about one particular person I was putting on, was which. We used to do Gary Glitter every year.
Right.
And we used to do it at the Top Rank, and it was like just Christmas sing-along. It's fine. And we thought, next year we'll put them in the Brighton Centre, and because it's bigger, you know, one holds 2,000, one holds 5,000. So the day comes, I'm sitting there in the green room having a bit of supper, and then and all the audience is in, and they come to me and say, "We've got a slight problem. The band's done the sound check. Don't know. Gary Glitter's done a runner. He ran away and with his young girlfriend.
Right.
And we couldn't find him at all. So we had to cancel the gig, and there was a lot of angry people there, you know.
Yeah.
And I did meet him. We had a chat about it, and we put it on again, and the second time was fine.
Yeah. You
know? But after that, they did it themselves. You know, it's one of those things where they can see the money in it. So,
And do you have to kind of, is it a stressful job promoting big bands?
I suppose artists? So. It's a bit like, I always think it's a bit like gambling on horses, you know. There's the agency in London who sell you the band, and then they charge you to do that. And it's up to you to sell the product, and then hopefully the audience will come along. And sometimes it was two steps forward, one step back.
Yeah.
Who knows? So it's
And it's kind of a bit uncertain as well, I guess, a career, because it's difficult to plan, isn't it? Because you don't know what acts are coming up. So it's kind of a bit of an uncertain career, isn't it, for many people?
It is, but
a lot of risk.
It's a lot of risk, but I was working with a couple of other people, Bob Fisher and Alan McGowan, who were in music businesses in London, in London and would know about the up-and-coming bands, so that would be good. While I was doing all this, this was not the daytime job. I was working at the what is now the University of Brighton.
Yeah. Yeah.
Doing stuff there. I ended up technician there, and I started off as a technician there, and then ended up managing the theatre and the gallery, the Salisbury Theatre and the gallery on the front. So
yeah.
That's I was also doing that at the same time. It seemed to me at one point there wasn't anything, everything rolled into one. There weren't weekends or anything. We were running nightclubs 3 days a week as well.
Okay, we'll leave it there for now. We're going to join us for the second half. We're going to be speaking to Colin about the Brighton Fringe Festival, third biggest fringe festival in the world, I think. But we're going to hear more from Colin in the second half, so join us then. So I'm joined here again for the vote by Colin Matthews. We'll talk about your illustrious career in the first half, and we'll just touch a bit upon that again. Running nightclubs, is that as difficult as it looks?
It can be very stressful.
Yes.
We used to run under the hotels in Brighton, some of the hotels, like the Queen's Hotel. Where Revenge is now, we built that up there. It's stressful, yes. I suppose in the 70s, nightclubbing was just coming in, what you think of nightclubbing now. So we're sort of like, I suppose, the pioneers and that. And
when did that start? Because I mean, I'm still stuck in the 90s when it comes to nightclubs. So that's paradox.
I think it's like mid 70s.
Right.
Starting on a you used to go and hire a hotel on a weekly basis, and it was always touch and go whether it worked.
Brilliant.
I'm working at the art college in the basement of the art college. We used to run bands, disco nights there. And the other thing I used to do is there were still, even then, lots of foreign students coming in. So we used to run nightclubs for them in certain places.
Yeah.
And that. I used to employ DJs and we started the Savannah Club in the 80s, which is a pneumatic club.
How long did that go on for? Because I don't remember the Savannah Club, but I've heard of it and a lot about it. So
it started off in a Queen's Hotel in about 1982, and where Revenge is now, we revamped that above the fish and chip shop, and Savannah was there.
Yeah.
Then it ended up in West Street in the end, and then probably 5-6 years,
What makes a good club then? Because some just go on, don't they? They just last forever. I mean, I remember the Honey Club back in the day. That went on for a long time.
Yeah.
That was a good club.
I think Savannah Club had this door policy where everyone had to dress up. And we were quite strict about that. And we would turn people away. So it's quite exclusive in that way. The other thing we used to do, and this is thinking of the 80s, is we used to take photographs of people actually there, and then display them on the next week on the screens that we had, and that caused a stir and that, and even down to like how much do you want to take that one off on with the wrong person there? So at the same time, we're still promoting bands. We're still doing all that. So.
Another big job, we need a lot of time to talk about it, is you chair the Brighton Fringe Festival, so that's a big job. So the Brighton Fringe Festival, the third biggest fringe festival in the world, is that?
Yes, it is now. Yes, there's Edinburgh, which it's obviously had a head start. The other one, strangely enough, that people say, really? Is Adelaide. Big. Then there's us, yes.
Yeah.
I think last year, we did just under 5,000 performances, and there were just over 1,000 events, so it's huge. Yeah.
And that stretches, that is the whole of Brighton and Hove, or have we, because we were talking about, would it expand outside of Brighton and Hove? I seem to remember there are some events that do take place outside of Brighton.
Yes.
Yeah, Lewis is...
Yeah, we're trying to put it more out into the regions.
Yeah.
A lot of it does happen around the core of Brighton, and it's also trying to get some of the stuff to work in the outer regions of Brighton, Brighton, yes. And we started registrations last week, and we did it in Brighton, of course, but we've also did it in Crawley and did it in Worthing. And we are talking to those people like New Haven, Worthing and that, to have an element of Brighton Fringe there as well.
So, yeah. So what does your job as, and when you chair it, what does that involve? Because this is a big, big task, isn't it? So what you've had, you oversee it or?
Oversee it. I'm a bit like a helicopter chair. I hover over the top of the whole thing because there's a CEO and a whole team working, which you have to leave them to do that.
Yes.
It's us. I chair a board of that looks after, that makes all the legalities are right, or the fact that we're keeping to our mission statement and what have you, and doing all the charitable stuff and promoting it really.
What's been the big success of Brighton Fringe? There's been lots of successes. What sticks out in your mind as being, you know, very successful? Something that you'd want to continue in the coming years?
I just love and I can remember back even down in the festival days, the Spiegel tent came in, you know, you're talking 20 years ago. And the Spiegel tent has been with us, I don't know, I can't remember how many years, probably 8 or 9 years. And Adrian, who runs that, him and I were talked about getting it back here, and we got it here, and now here it is.
Yeah, firm fixture, really.
Firm fixture. And the other one is, it's seen Nikki at the Warren, expanding the Warren, and I think that's a great thing. When people talk about how many people they had through the door, which the numbers which we can quote, the other thing is it's these places become places for people to meet, just to meet, you know. It's a place to go during that whole month where, you know, mums could take their kids after school and have sit down and have a chat and that. So it's more than just about... it's a whole feel of the whole month.
It is, And people look for... Actually, people take time off from their... They book their holiday and so they can go to Fringe events. Because we were broadcasting live from the Warren last year. Yale, my colleague, presenter colleague, broadcasted live from the Warren. So that would be a big success as well. And do you see your job as kind of promoting up-and-coming talent? I mean, the answer is probably yes or
no. Well, obviously, we have bursaries. People have... sponsor bursaries where we sort of aim at certain groups to, you know, that wouldn't otherwise have that opportunity, or you're in a certain age bracket, like if you're between 18 and 25 and you want to get into that, we can help you with that. But equally, if you're over 60, we could do that as well. So we have these bursaries. I think last year the bursaries came to a value of £22,000, which helps people put on productions. It helps one particular award, helps the people go abroad. And I think they went to Australia and performed and that. So also we have connections with quite a few embassies, Nordic embassies and Dutch embassies and that, where we swap acts and what have you. And, so you get, I think last year we had 34 different countries performing here. So so it's quite expensive.
And what do you see? How do you see the future of Brighton Fringe Festival then? Because you were talking about expanding it, you know, to Crawley and other places. Yeah. But what makes that work? Because it definitely works.
It works. I think one of the things I came on as chair when I first started was, it's the Fringe is great and it's big and that. But the Fringe as a name isn't well known, you know. I want to get the Fringe as rolling off people's lips, if you like, rather than just for the people of Brighton. Yeah. A bit like you say Edinburgh. I just like to get the name known more. That's what I was going to
say. And one of the things that worked this year as well was there was kind of a... you could have a taster event. There was a kind of a taster session of what you might want to see, because it's almost so big, the brochure's ridiculously big, and it's very difficult to navigate your way around the brochure, isn't it? Was that might just be me.
No, I think you're right, and you're fine. I have people asking me, and what we do is we get all the staff to give their picks and that, and then distill it down and that. I mean, I find it. Because you just don't know what's going to be good either, you know, what comes up, you know. Bright is very good. If something's good, everyone seems to know very quickly, you know. So I don't particularly book a lot. I just go on the spur of the...
That's when me and my wife do that. That's exactly what we're doing. It actually works as well.
Yes, and you see some things you probably will never see
Or
never want to see again.
Exactly, we won't mention them. So just before we go, you're doing something at Hurst Pier Point, was it? A festival there?
Maybe Hurst Pier Point.
Mention that briefly. Yeah.
I direct a two-week festival there every year. That's at the end of the last 2 weeks in September, which is a village community festival. And we have about 80 events from classical through to comedy, through to films, through to drama, and lots of free events and that. And we close the high street for our, what we call a Super Sunday, which is like a big carnival, really, and that we had half the village out last time, which is probably about 3,500 people.
Yeah. And when does that take place?
Last two weeks in September.
Yeah. And for this year, for Brighton Fringe, I guess you're planning next year's Fringe Festival. I mean, is that how it works? You kind of start planning.
Well, yeah, you're planning before the other one finishes.
Exactly.
I mean, we don't program. You know, it's open access, so anyone can apply, and long as it's decent, we put it on, and it could be a performance of you and me like this, if you like, through to hundreds, and that. What we try to do is help people market their product, or help them find venues, or help venues find acts, bring promoters and agents in to see the acts, so they can buy the acts and take them on tour. And that, so it's we're sort of like a big enabling body, really. So
okay, I think we'll leave it there for now. Colin, thanks for coming in again, and I'm sure we'll be catching up again soon. All the best for the future.
Thank you very much.
Yes, thanks a lot.
Bye.